So you. Okay. So we welcome you to this session, No Change Angel session, which has at its theme or its focus the people or the persons who are embedded in the systems we have been discussing since yesterday, and who have to work and deal with all the tensions and ambiguities and let's say compromises that that this whole conference is about. The idea of this session is to make it more participatory, in the sense that I would like to invite the audience to take part in the discussion. We have tried to make the presentations of the invited speakers shorter than maybe we had in the plenary sessions, but engage in questions and answers or comments to which you are invited. So if you feel that there is something we should be addressing and that you are not hearing, I ask you to say so. I negotiated intensely this morning, so we would have, firstly, a slightly different order of seating, and two mics for the audience, so please make use of them. One is now lonely here on the first chair, so this doesn't look so good. So, but there's also David in the back, who has a mic. So if you, I don't know how it's going to work, but if you want to say something and you have the mic, you can say it, or you make a sign. Or, of course, I will also open the questions to the floor, to the audience. And I hope we will get your questions or your comments into our ears. I present Isabel and Christina. They're translating, because we have some Spanish intervention. Mainly Cesar is going to speak Spanish. So if you don't speak Spanish, whenever there's someone Spanish speaking, you need the earphones. Is that all I have to announce? Okay. Yeah, if you have technical problems, David is there to help you. Okay. So are we set? Okay, I will briefly present myself. My name is Kerstin Meyer. I'm an economist and an artist. I have a foot in both industries. My economic professional work is in the development industry, which is represented here today on the stage, as well as the arts industry, which is also represented on the stage. I'm an economist, so I think more in these structural terms. So maybe that explains the word industry. I live in Berlin now. My cultural training is from West Africa. I've worked long years in West Africa, and this is also where I learned to appreciate the culture of debate. So I was hoping that we could have some of this here. And I live in Berlin now, and I want to make as someone who lives in Berlin and who's close to artists in Berlin. I have lots of friends who are artists in Berlin. I have a political statement to make, or a mission. I wanted to show you this. This is artists in Berlin have gathered since last year to sign to work on a manifesto, which is called, in German, Haben und Hallo? Can you still hear me?
We hear you.
Ausgefallen, komisch. To have and to need, haben und brauchen. Can you hear me? Good idea. Thank you. Haben und brauchen, to have and to need. Is anybody here from to haben und brauchen? Yeah. Okay. Well, I wanted this to be represented here because artists in Berlin have gathered to collectively voice their comments on their claims on working as conditions of work for artists in Berlin. And this was a long process. It's been like 8-6 months. There was a trigger, but that's not so important now. I mean, what's more important is that there's this movement now, and for the time being, the strongest claims are against what we've been hearing yesterday, against the dispossession of the commons, like against privatization of common land or common of immobilien sector. What's that?
Real estate.
Yeah, thank you. And that's one big aspect of it, because Berlin used to be very attractive for artists because of cheap rents and working spaces, and that's changing fast. And of course, gentrification, everybody knows this issue, but now it's being, I mean, there's the voice of the artists to be put in front of the policy makers. And the other aspect which I found interesting and maybe more debatable is the artists' claim to be paid, you know? They actually say, we're cultural workers, we are not something special in that sense, because we also need the salary, we need to be paid. And I wasn't, so we want, in a way they're saying, we want to be part of the system, you know, we want to be a part of the system that we are actually maybe working against in our work. So I find this interesting. I only have one copy right now, but you can have a look at it. And maybe later in our debates, the people from Haben und Brauchen can refer to this, and then you know what it is. So so this was the Berlin point of view, while now I turn to our invited guests who are from very far and from three different continents. I start with the ladies. Leah. Yeah? You're not a lady?
A person.
Okay. I start with the person. Okay. I start with Leah. Leah is from Romania. She lives and works in Sibiu. Leah and Bucharest. Yeah. She has been doing art since 85. What? 80s? Since the 80s. And now she says her working life as an artist is traveling. Half of the year she's not at home, she travels, including to Asia now, is it? You're showing your work in Asia? Yeah, well, you will tell us about this. And about her work, she told me, I occupy all artistic positions according to what is needed. So maybe you say something about this later. Yeah, I'll make a quick round, because the idea is, you know, everybody who's here, and then each after they will make a longer presentations, but we start debating on the way. Yeah. So another very nice person on this stage is Gabi Nkobo. Gabi is from Durban. I met her in Durban once, working in Johannesburg. And to describe her practice, she told me it's a triangle. One corner of the triangle is I'm an artist, the other corner is I'm an educator, and the third corner is I'm a curator, and an independent curator. So that's Gabi, and we'll hear more of her. The person to my right is Cesar Lopez. My Spanish is limited. He's a musician from Bogota. And he is here with his collaborator or patron. I'm going to ask more questions about this. This is Peter Hauschnick. He is from GIZ, German Development Corporation. So that's why I said we would be discussing development industry as well. He represents the peace-building project Cerca Paz in Bogota. And Cerca Paz has a collaboration with this musician, Cesar Lopez. And I think we could be interested in asking further questions about their collaboration and how it evolved and what it signifies maybe for both of them and for the works. So, yeah. So, this is the people on the stage. Do you have any direct questions to this? Could I ask a question to the audience, just to have an idea? If we think that there's maybe, like as an economist, I would think, okay, we have two industries, art industry and development industry, and we have two types of affiliations, or like, let's say, yeah, individual affiliations. One is the artists, maybe, and the other is more the institution that works with the artist. So we have like two artists. She is an artist and a curator, so a bit one step closer to the institution, and Peter would be the institution. I was wondering here, who of you considers himself more towards the artist side, and who considers himself more to the institution side? Just to have an idea who you are. Okay, artists. Ooh, that's many. Okay, thank you. Institutions. One, two, three. Okay, that's shy. Okay, it's interesting. Did you see? There's lots of artists. Okay. Okay, let's hear an artist voice. Leah.
Since I was small, I wanted to change the world. This was a fixed idea. I still want, in the meantime, I change myself quite a lot, but maybe I also contribute in my context with some things. In 1995, I saw in New York the Guardian Angel School, and I like how it sounds. There are people who are prepared to take action in case of a catastrophe or whatever, accident at the underground. I like the idea that people need to be trained to do something. Otherwise, it's chaotic, maybe, the movement. So, can I have the image? I study art 14 years, was academic, I learned almost everything. They train our hand more than our brain. I participate in the revolution, 1989 revolution. 1 year, in 1990, we had to be on the street to fight for a democratic society and institutions. So in that time, I received, I applied, and together with my husband, which is also an artist, we were lucky to receive a studio. But the studio was not a place to produce paintings, sculptures, objects, or whatever in these crazy times, but was becoming more and more a meeting point, debate space, platform, and things like that. So you see some images here with activities from 1990 till 2000 when I made this poster. I'm interested in timelines. I wanted to understand what was happening when. I want to locate myself in my culture, in the big culture. Doing this, I discovered a lot of interesting things, so I will mention some. The mainstream timelines are presenting a lot of wars, but less discoveries, interesting ideas, culture events, and things like that. And I was disappointed, and I'm still disappointed, because they continue like that. Almost in each book you will see, check me. And I think that education, it's really the key moment, the starting, is very important. We need to share what we know in order to be capable of having a dialogue. My latest project, it's a knowledge museum. You can see these days, I mean, till April, in IFA Gallery. In this, I really want to build a real museum. We'll have 7 departments: Earth, Body, Culture, Science, universe, knowledge in general, and art. I'm imagining to be a starting point for somebody, doesn't matter, very young or old, to reorientate themselves or to discover where to go next, to have very quickly basic information and then to go in other museums, read books and so on. I was talking a lot with young people and they complained that it's a lot of information, but actually nobody makes a shortcut for them. And I also know that sometimes you are not capable of seeing things in front of your eyes till somebody is not pointing out. So I think I'm a kind of person who is pointing out. This conference and others like these events, or the exhibition in which I participated in West, and not only, also at home, but in West more, empower me and I was all the time feeling obliged to give the other what I knew. So in a modest way, we empower people, but who wants to be empowered? So at home I encouraged a kind of research attitude and a little bit social and political attitude. And I think art is not what used to be. Art change according with the needs in the society, in our context, and the thing is to do the best what you can out of what you have.
Thank you, Leah. I heard Leah has a show at IFA Gallery in Linienstraße. Leah and her husband Dan, a joint show. To my mind, Leah, you're a successful artist, are you?
You know, if somebody will say I'm not, I will say yes, I am a successful artist. But being among friends, now I don't have to be so tough, and I will say I work so hard that I don't know what means success. Because I work from the morning to the night. I struggle all these times. So I think I'm happy and lucky to manage in the way I want. I'm a nonconformist. I don't like to somebody to tell me to turn to the other person to talk. I'm talking. I'm curious.
I'm pointing to this because, to my mind, you're a successful artist. And I was wondering if this knowledge about how to become a successful artist, you know, for instance, what are the door openers, you know, how does it work, you know. I went to a talk, a lecture you gave, and something you said was, you have to know how your work functions in the system, you know. You have to understand how your work works. And the other thing you said was, or maybe it was Dan actually, who said that you have to be present, like in shows. You have to be confirmed, you know, you have to be present, and then you have to be confirmed again by the system in order to, you know, go into another show or make another step. And this kind of knowledge, I mean, I thought, well, that would be probably very interesting. Is that also something that you put in your shows? You know, in your... I saw there was a mind map of keywords for criticality. Yeah? Is that ironic?
No. No, I like to make shortcuts for people. So in my diagrams, I try to combine a lot of books on a single sheet of paper, which I blow up. Sometimes depends on the space and the objects I bought in the museum stores to help me a little bit to and people, if the viewer, to orientate themselves. Everything it's fine what you said, but also I like I have an idea. That if you want to be an artist, you have to figure out yourself at 80 years old, alone. Nobody will telling you till then that you are good or what you do is interesting and so on. You will do art, I will do. So I think you are the only one who knows better what you do and what you want to do, and here is the force. And then flexibility and adaptation and so on. Carol Mitchell, it's an author, American author, who an artist who became a coach and trainer and things like that for artists. Very simple in her book, How to Survive and Sell Works and things like that. She says that try the door which is open. If it's not open, the door for you, for the art system, then create an alternative. I believe in the alternative and I create it. So I'm considering a little bit in between spaces. Kick the door.
I said you can also kick the door open.
There's two mics at the beginning.
Yeah, I think we have so many rules, you know. The art should be in a certain way. The artist should behave in certain ways. Actually, if we feel something and we have an intuition, I think we have to follow this and no rules.
Could I put a question to Leah?
Yeah.
You may have noticed at the outset of the meeting when you asked us for a show of hands whether we were considered ourselves artists or institutions, I didn't raise my hand. I wasn't indulging in the sly politician's game of abstaining. I simply didn't know which camp I belonged to. By no stretch of the imagination do I consider myself to be an artist, but if anybody said I was an institution, I think I would take issue with that. But it's because I'm an academic. And if institutions come into my professional life, it is the art school system, the education system. And I want to ask Leah about this, because you said this is a golden opportunity for me to speak to somebody with your background and experience, that you've made the transition from a communist system to whatever else has taken its place. My experience of art education goes back further than that. And I can remember a time when the school that I work at, which is in Glasgow, we hosted an exhibition from the Moscow Academy of Fine Art in the middle of the 1980s, before anybody knew the whole thing was going to blow apart in a few years. And it was a very instructive experience for us to see how the education system operated on the other side of the Iron Curtain. We were struck by several things. Not only the work that the students were doing, but also what we learnt about how the system was structured and how it fitted into the social context over there. The first thing that the students responded to was the extraordinary standard of technical accomplishment of the students. They knew how to paint. In the old-fashioned terms, debatable, obviously, but many of our own students were very, very humbled by the fact that they were working in a system where effectively we were saying to our students, okay, go into your studio for 4 years and come out doing something interesting, and we'll leave you alone. We don't want to interfere. We're not going to teach you anything because teaching is kind of interfering with your creativity, blah, blah, blah. Over there, there was a program, and you learned the skill. You said that they trained your hand. What they told us was that you train your brain through your hand. There's no separation between the two. The other thing that we learned from it was that there was a 7-year program compared to the 4 years that we offered. They took art very seriously over there, and almost every graduating student was guaranteed a job, a salary earning situation in the system. We couldn't guarantee that to our students by any stretch of the imagination. I'd just like to know your views about what happened in Romania and how the education system, art education system, has changed in the meantime.
A little bit didn't change. I mean, a bit with video department, photo video department, but this is not a major change. You know, I created an archive to recuperate 15 years of lack of information about contemporary art. doing this, I become an archivist, a theoretician, curator, and so on. So for me, if somebody asks me what I am, I was trained like an artist, I am an artist, but I was occupying different positions, and I don't want to separate myself. Everything I did, I saw very organic. I was pushed. I didn't have any regrets to let paintings away or sculpture or objects or whatever. To survive of what you do, I was reading somewhere that we need between 4 and 9 professions to survive. In a way, I was creating my possibilities out of the needs. And I will say that we need, in a way, professions, combined professions and so on, for the whole alphabet. It's what I'm telling the young people I met. I really believe that it's good to be flexible. It doesn't matter you are an artist, you have other profession or whatever. So, and actually, I don't know the ideal education, but I'm trying with empathy, with modesty and so on. When I'm teaching somewhere, I'm trying to be the teacher I never had. But first I was trying with me. Yeah, too.
More comments or questions? I'm still in my head in the art system, not in the education system. Gabi, how do you kick the door open?
There's many ways. I'd like to do my presentation and then get to the door. Is it on? Okay, I'm going to talk about a very recent project that is still on in Durban. It was mentioned today that I come from Durban, but I live and work in Johannesburg. This project, which is titled Don't Panic, coincided with the climate change conference COP17, which took place in Durban in November. And it was Don't Panic, and the two words are separated by a stroke. This project was commissioned by the Goethe Institute. They approached me and they said, there's COP17, there's money, and this was very nice. Because I've never had an opportunity to make a project where there was money, and there was real money. It was really nice. At some point, the Heinrich-Böll Foundation, they came in with more money. So it was Christmas. And for me, I was really, really happy to go back to Durban, which is my city of birth, to do a project and a big project with money. In Durban, as an artist, I lived there. I tried to open many doors, and one of the doors that I really tried to open is the door of the Durban Art Gallery, which is a city gallery. Every city in South Africa has this municipal galleries. So there's a Johannesburg Art Gallery, there's a Durban Art Gallery, there's Bloemfontein, and all sorts of things. And they all have a collection that mostly starts with the, I would call it the colonials collection, because mostly it would be a bequest of a Sir Bailey or something that comes to that, how can I say it? That made these spaces possible in every South African city. So it would start from this collection, and then the gallery would be built. So there is that history of the gallery for me. And of course, this is very true, that if a door is closed, you open another door. And we did this as a collective in Devon called Third Eye Vision, very much inspired by the closed doors as well. And so we created our own reality in an old house, and this was nice and beautiful. And I left Durban and I went to work at the National Gallery in Cape Town. This was, I did that for less than 2 years. I went to work for Cape Africa Platform, which was an organization trying to make a biennale that was not a biennale. It was a major failure, but a very interesting failure, and one of my major learning points as well as a person working in the arts. And then I ran away from South Africa because I needed to think about what I was doing there, and I went to study at the Center for Curatorial Studies in New York at Bard College. And there it was clear to me that for me to exist in South Africa, I have to have that triangle that you spoke about in the beginning, to have a space in which the boundaries between art and curatorial work is blurred, to be in a space where I can contribute in education. So I am a faculty member at WITS, and for me this is part of my way of making art, I think, and thinking about space. And then I'm also an independent curator, and for me this independent is very important, because it was very, very clear to me that I did not want a job that will label me as a curator. And I wanted to do that by myself, so that I can play as much as I can and have fun. And so I was approached by the Goethe Institute. It made me think about Durban a lot in those times when we were struggling and trying to open these doors that were closed. And the landscape has changed as well. There has been some kinds of transformation, institutional transformations, that enabled me to go with a proposal which started from a PowerPoint presentation, because of course this, I was kind of afraid of this subject of climate change. It's a big thing, and I didn't want to also close myself up, you know, as a curator who does climate things. I did not want to commission artists to respond to this. I thought that would be too much of a burden. I just started to think about all the things that I've seen in different kinds of exhibitions about identity, about migration, about politics, and many things. And I wanted to return to those images in order to create an exhibition. And that's what I did. So there were no commissions, and I started also from a very from an education. For me, education was the focal point in thinking about this. So I went to Durban a lot, and I was speaking to young people. For me, with climate change, what was most important, coming from Durban and knowing the situation, the art situation in Durban, was the idea of the artistic climate. So I looked at different kinds of climates, artistic, political, economic. But for me, this artistic climate was on the top of my list, and I went to Durban, and I found a program at the BET Center, the Battle Arts Trust, which is a community art center that runs a program for young people who cannot afford to go to a university. And then I thought it would be good to focus my attention on these young people and have a discussion, an ongoing discussion with them about my ideas, and also involve them in the exhibition. So in the images, I can't really remember what images are, but you see different situations, not so much the exhibition in the space, I think there is a one image, but also other things that were happening around the exhibition. This format of making a forum for me was important, so that the audience and the invited speakers sit on one table as well and discuss. And this is a space at the Durban Art Gallery. It's a really beautiful space. It's over decorated, so it also was a challenge, but it allowed me to also break the rules of the space, but also kind of follow the logic of the space at the same time. And so there were many things that were happening also outside, interventions, the waterfall on the bridge was painted by six of the young artists from the BED Center. And for me, it was also important to activate the site by doing an intervention. Basically, what I wanted to open up to the young people who are interested in art in Durban is various ways of working, of creating space, of taking up space. So one of the projects that I really, really liked is about a tree, which is called the Dead Man's Tree, which was cut down in Durban in the 1950s. It was about 100 years old. And I started to read an alternative guide to Durban that was written in the 70s. And for me, this was interesting because the city has changed, and Durban is one place that in which this change is visible through the renaming of the streets. So using the same map that was used in the 80s is not possible because the street names have changed. And I mean, people still refer to the old names, but you know, the change is quite visible. So for me, this one project was really trying to get these young people understand a different way of working, which is creative research. So they embarked on a research project for 7 weeks, which was also represented in the exhibitions. The story of the exhibition, Don't Panic, I have also a catalogue, is a long, long and winded story that I can't finish in 5 minutes, but I hope that, you know, some questions can come from the floor later.
You're invited. Well, before you think up your questions or comments, I have talked to her before about this show, and there were a couple of things that intrigued me. Well, one thing was this Christmas type of situation where you have lots of money, in particular money to pay artists, apparently. And also, I thought it was interesting, maybe that's just my perception, that you have they coincided, the climate change summit and the show, but it wasn't a coincidence, no? I mean, you were meant to make a show on climate issues, no?
No, I was commissioned to make a show that would coincide with the climate change conference.
This is the wording?
Yes.
Wow. And she also said there was a conditionality on the show, it should only be African artists. And that, I mean, I know this is a sensitive issue because you make an ethnic show, I know this from the Biennale in Dakar, it's very heavily contested. So her reaction to this was, how did you word it? Make doing it without doing it? That was the wording. Yeah. I'm doing it without doing it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it wasn't so much a problem, you know. I don't mind working with African artists. but yes, I was doing it without doing it. I wasn't, like, I never used the word Africa in anything. I'm very much interested in a production that is made by artists from Africa. So I looked all over the world, for artists who are working and based in different parts of the world. For me, the focus was really Durban. I wanted to do a site-specific exhibition that addresses the issues in Durban more than doing an African show.
Yeah, I also like the idea of not burdening the artist with a topic. That's really interesting. We had an intervention that artists usually, well, often they have to respond to something, and I don't know if you all were here last night when we had one artist responding to a letter. Did you see that performance? The last thing in the evening?
Yes.
Yes, oh, okay. Anyway, but whatever you think about it, but he was responding to the invitation. Yeah. You didn't know to what that was the problem, maybe, yeah? Yeah, so, yeah, I remember that. There was one more issue. I asked Gabi, maybe a bit too forthcomingly, if she could live off her work yet, being an early, and then she said the issue of survival, no, was new to her. Yeah.
I think it's always an issue of survival. I mean, there's people who are living, and then there's people who are surviving. And I think I am a survivor, and I think you are. It's a work in progress as well.
But Leah, yeah. You said you don't live off your art either.
Sometimes I sell, but I'm not focused on this. I earn my money doing stage design in Romania because it's a little bit well paid. Out of lectures, workshops, exhibitions, and I'm living in Romania, which is a little bit cheaper than living in the West, where I will feel a lot of pressure to make money.
Can I ask Caesar first?
Yes.
Caesar, can you live off your art?
Yeah. Yes, I play my concerts every year, and I pay the rent and I pay the light and the telephone.
Are you rich?
Huh?
Are you rich? I mean, wealthy?
I'm very happy.
Sorry.
Well, I was going to say, like, who has it feels it, the issue about the economical change. You know, it was the people who had it that felt it, but my kind of survival is that I was always struggling with money, for me it was really really hard to have money to do an exhibition because I don't know how to use it, and I try to save a lot of money as well. But doing also the right thing, like for me, it was paying artist fees, but at the same time finding different ways of shipping work, which is takes a lot of money. So I didn't quite. Maybe I shipped two things. And I found other solutions. So, yeah, solutions.
The audience. The participants. You have your own. We need it.
You mentioned that you worked on with young people on creative research and as part of the project. Do you feel that your focus was more on the content of the project or the exhibition, or was it more on the process of working with young people? How do you assess it?
Yeah, I would say it's a process. I would say I focused on the context a lot of Durban. many people who travel to South Africa to look for artists, to find possibilities, to see what's going on, hardly go to Durban. Durban is not a city that is active. It's kind of stifled by its small townness and its holidayness, because it's this is the warmest place to be in winter. It's next to the sea, so it's more popular for domestic tourism. And so this, I mean, to host a large event like the Climate Change Conference in itself was a big boost for the city of Durban, in the way that the World Cup was not, because it, you know, maybe there were four matches that were played in Durban, if not five. But this is an event that lasted for like 2 weeks, 12 days, just in Durban. So there was this excitement from the cab drivers, from everyone. Everyone was doing COP things, you know. It was like, I'm busy with this COP thing. And yeah, so that was really interesting. And I wanted to insert myself within that excitement, and do it without doing it as well, because I mean, for me, I think the project was kind of avoiding also the subject. And so to say also don't panic, I was also trying to be controversial. But at the same time, to say don't panic calls for a panic in itself. But yeah, for me it was, yes, the process, the ways of working and ways of thinking, but also very much thinking about the context. Yeah.
Any more desire to speak up? We go to Colombia. Cesar? You are always a little lag behind because you're listening to the translation. Cesar Lopez, famous Colombian musician. Would you like to present your work?
Hola. Sí. Vamos a hacer una prueba de la traducción. He estado escuchando muy atentamente. Estoy perdiendo segundos valiosos. Pero esto de perder el tiempo es muy artístico. Decía que estoy perdiendo segundos valiosos, pero que esto de perder el tiempo es muy artístico también. Voy a narrar rápidamente en mi trabajo. Yo soy músico colombiano que desde el año 94, a raíz de la muerte de mi papá, empecé a recorrer las calles y los barrios y las cárceles y a trabajar con las pandillas y a trabajar con las comunidades vulnerables en Colombia. Y empecé a viajar de un lado para otro y a tocar de un lado para otro mi guitarra, hasta que en el año 2003 explota una bomba en un club muy, muy famoso en Colombia. No le pongas. Y muere mucha gente. Y en ese momento yo decido salir con unos amigos a cantar justo al lado de las víctimas. Y allí nace un proyecto que yo bauticé en ese momento el Batallón Artístico de Reacción Inmediata. Un grupo de artistas que reaccionaba inmediatamente a hechos de violencia en las ciudades. Cuando una comunidad era lesionada, cuando una persona era asesinada, llegábamos lo más rápido posible al lugar de los hechos a tocar y a cantar, con la intención de acompañar a las víctimas en la sensación que tenían de dolor, de rabia, de indignación. En una de esas salidas del Batallón Artístico de Reacción Inmediata sucede algo que quiebra la vida mía para siempre en el año 2003, y fue que tratando de acercarme a las ruinas de una bomba que acababa de estallar, un soldado me empuja y me quiebra mi guitarra con su fusil. En ese momento quedamos frente a frente, él y yo, yo con mi guitarra rota y él con su fusil, y nos miramos a los ojos. Y es en ese evento de la vida en el que nace este instrumento escopetarra, que del que voy a hablarles un poco. Esto es un fusil AK-47 que tiene una historia muy, muy larga. Está consignada en un libro del escritor colombiano Germán Castro Caicedo. Vladimiro Montesinos, ministro de Defensa de Perú. ¿Cuál era el cargo exacto? Exactamente, asesor del presidente Alberto Fujimori. Hace un negocio importante y en una guerra que supuestamente había con el Ecuador, dice que necesita comprar 10.000 fusiles AK-47. Los traen desde Jordania en un avión. Y cuando el avión viene, se desvía y entra a territorio colombiano y lanza 10.000 fusiles en paracaídas sobre la selva de un departamento llamado Guaviare. Como decían que Vladimiro Montesinos trabajaba para la CIA, pensaron los guerrilleros que tenía un chip incorporado en esta sección para detectarlos y dan la orden de desaparecer los fusiles. Es así como los fusiles terminan en manos de los paramilitares. Y un muchacho de nombre Oliver, en enero del 2006, dice que desea abandonar la guerra para siempre y entrega este fusil. En un proceso con las Naciones Unidas, logramos recibir el fusil y transformarlo en esta guitarra. Este fusil, además, esta guitarra que tengo acá, además pertenece a la ciudad de Berlín, porque Nos lo prestó la GIZ ayer, pero lo entregamos en el 2009 con motivo de los 20 años de la caída del muro como un símbolo de la transformación. Tiene para nosotros mucho sentido que ha ido adquiriendo con el tiempo. Tal vez una de las cosas más impresionantes la dijeron aquí también unos académicos alemanes cuando nos decían: es el hombre primitivo quien puede disparar con un solo dedo, pero es la labor y el proceso artístico que le implica al hombre usar sus 10 dedos, el cerebro y el corazón, para construir una melodía. Y es lo que está aquí manifestado, como está manifestado también la posibilidad del cambio. Si un arma que nació para ser arma, que fue pensada para ser un arma, pudo cambiar, ¿por qué algún ser humano no podría hacerlo? Y es así como nos dedicamos a viajar por todo el país y por todo el mundo, tocando conciertos en cárceles, con niños, con jóvenes, en pandillas. Y ahorita que estaba oyéndolos a ellos, yo fui muy juicioso y escribí muchas notas anoche y para la conversación, pero cambia un poco porque empiezo a pensar en todas las personas que he conocido a través de esta historia. Y tal vez es más valioso si me gasto estos 2 minutos mencionándolos a ellos. La señora María, que en una noche los paramilitares entran a su casa, rompen la puerta, cogen a su esposo y se lo llevan arrastrado. Y ella y sus hijos quedan desamparados. Y después de 3 semanas de no tener noticias de su esposo, ella tiene que empezar a lavar la ropa de sus vecinas en el río cercano, el río La Miel, para conseguir recursos. Y un día, lavando la ropa, ve bajar el cadáver de su esposo flotando por el río. Lo reconoce por la camisa que llevaba puesta. Y ella decide en un acto de resistencia y en un acto de reparación simbólica que cada viernes va al río, moja la mejor camisa que tenía su esposo, espera que se seque al sol, se la pone y dice que siente que su esposo la abraza. Un proyecto en Cali, Colombia, de unos muchachos que sin tener ningún conocimiento de video, es más, en un ejercicio poco sano, se roban una cámara de video y cuando no encuentran quién se las compre, empiezan, la prenden y empiezan a grabarse a ellos mismos bailando y haciendo graffiti. La alcaldía les ofrece pasar ese material por la televisión local y el décimo programa era el programa más visto en la televisión regional. Una orquesta de niños en Cúcuta que no tienen instrumentos porque no tienen recursos, pero tocan en el aire y hacen conciertos tocando en el aire como gesto de resistencia contra la violencia y contra la pobreza. Un grupo de muchachos en Pereira que están dentro de la cárcel y siendo una de las cárceles llamada La 40, una de las cárceles más peligrosas de Colombia, deciden proponer un ejercicio artístico dentro de la cárcel para que la gente intercambie canciones de rap en vez de agredirse físicamente con objetos, con armas blancas o con cuchillos. Y es así como logran llevar la cárcel a una de las más pacíficas del país, a través de un ejercicio artístico proponiendo intercambio de música y no de agresiones. Y así podríamos seguir contando historias de gente que me he ido encontrando y que ha ido inspirando este trabajo. Lo único que yo tendría que decir de esto es que hemos logrado, por ejemplo, en las favelas de Río de Janeiro, sacar más de 200 niños de las bandas de traficantes para que estudien música en el proceso que lidera la organización Afro Reggae, que en las comunas de Medellín hay un proceso intenso, poderoso, de muchachos haciendo rap constructivo. Y yo les iba a cantar una canción, pero se acabó el tiempo. Voy a quitarle unos minutos a Peter, ¿sí? Claro.
Quisiera pedir un favor. Anoche en Buenos Aires murió Alberto Spinetta, un músico de mi generación, gran músico rockero nacional, y como César lo conoce, quisiera pedir por favor que dediques tu canción a Alberto Spinetta.
Por supuesto. Gracias. Que sí. Todos crecimos oyendo la música de este gran artista argentino y bueno, entonces voy a tocar y después ya dejamos en palabras de Peter. Tengo que cerrar, para cerrar mi participación, prefiero hacerlo con la canción. Entonces lo último que tengo que decir es que yo estoy aquí porque he iniciado un proceso desde hace 3 años de la mano de la GIZ en un ejercicio de sistematización. Y esto ha sido trascendental para la labor que hacemos y es entender cómo hago yo lo que yo hago. ¿Por qué lo hago? Y en ese sentido, cuando he podido entender qué es esto que yo estoy practicando día tras día, en cárcel tras cárcel, barrio por barrio, lo he podido hacer mejor y estamos transformando más número de personas gracias a esta intervención. Y aprovecho para darle un agradecimiento público también a Peter por haber creído en esta iniciativa. Y no sé si vale, pero quisiera pedir un aplauso para ese apoyo que he recibido.
¿Tienes una base? Aquí viene esa base.
¿Sí? De verdad. Entonces vamos a hablar brevemente de los...
allá vienen llenos de hijos de mamá. Tan valientes se fueron de casa sin pensar. A pelear otra guerra perdida de la humanidad. ¿Y quién cuidará a nuestros hijos? ¿Cuántos tendrán hambre y frío? ¿Y cómo saber si están vivos? Si allá vuelven los helicópteros vacíos. Hablo sobre la libertad de los hombres cautivos. Hablo por los que ya no están y por los muertos vivos. Hablo sobre la soledad de las madres sin sus hijos. Esos hijos ya no hablarán. Se los llevó el río, toda bala es perdida y toda víctima es hermana. Tanta guerra y mentira, ¿y qué vendrá mañana?
Gracias. Thank you.
Thank you, Caesar. I didn't understand all of the lyrics, but I understood Toda Bala Es Perdida, which is, I think, the title of your last project, which is a CD with lots of artists singing your texts and your music, which was produced with Peter. This is a bit difficult now, but I would like us to turn to the development aspect of it, because I think that's the kind of goal or the conceptual objective that you have when you work with artists. Peter works in a peace-building project. Peter is an engineer by, I forgot to say that, an engineer by training, construction engineer. Please, Peter, why don't you speak?
Well, thank you. First of all, I have to make some sort of clarification. I am not an institution. So I do, however, represent an organization, which is called the GIZ, that is right. And 5 years ago, I had the opportunity to work for that organization in Colombia, starting this peace program. So when we talk about a climate of violence, to what Gabi mentioned, the different ways of describing climate, and Colombia is a climate, or has a climate of violence. That's why the German cooperation is there. And engaging in a peace program. And when I got there, and as you just mentioned, Kerstin, from my formation, I originally was a civil engineering. Now I'm from building bridges to building peace somehow. It's an interesting development. And of course, that program, as conceived by governmental cooperation, was focused very much on good governance, on transparency, on building civil society in order to engage in a constructive dialogue with the state institutions. But this is not enough. If you're working in a climate of violence, where violence is an accepted means of resolving conflict, eliminating the other is what you do. So it's not enough just to work with institutions, it's not enough to work with organizations, you have to work with people. And I when I had the opportunity, and it was a pure accident when I met Cesar and had the first opportunity to listen to him, to listen to his words, to listen to his work, then it was clear to me that we need in this program also another approach. And I don't have to invent this approach, it's already there. So what I was lucky enough, this program in my back, this institution in my back, and finally, as we all know, German taxpayers' money in my back, I could do something. So that's also something which I have to clarify. It's not a situation of patronage. I don't, and this was the first conversation we had with Cesar, and I said, I want to work with you, I want to support your work, but my goal is not to make you a famous artist. My goal is not to produce a CD. Or my goal is not that you can live off your art. But my goal is to support your work, and yes, I know it's not very politically correct to say so in the context of artists, but yes, I want to use, in the very best sense, this work. Because what we do alone is not sufficient. What you do alone may be not sufficient, but together we can reach a common goal. So it was important that we had this conversation at the very beginning to clarify what is each part's role, what can we do and what can't we do. And I really welcome this 2 days of conference where we do have the chance to make it clear where do we come from and what do we want to do. But I sense, at least until now, having participated the day of yesterday, that we still are very much meshed up. It's all meshed up. We talk about arts, but coming from very different perspectives and, of course, very different objectives behind it. And so it's still somewhat difficult when you want to clarify your positions and even try to get to a point where you say, we agree to disagree. And I think this is very important, and I hope, for me at least now, being part of this, yesterday I said, I feel somewhat like an odd piece, because sitting here, being nominated as the institution, then of course lots of people say, and unfortunately, like you said, there was lots of money, it was the Heinrich-Böll, so all these German wonderful institutions, and this is something what we have to face too when we get into this contact. So, okay, there's the GIZ, the German government, now there's money, let's do something. And then to say, well, yes, there is money, but it is put to use for a certain goal. So we have to come together around this goal. And I think this is very important, and I guess this 2 days can also help to clarify that. I myself also was criticized, or at least questioned, maybe not criticized, but questioned is the better word, why and how do we do this work with artists? Because, you know, you have to strengthen capacity in the public organizations. You have to strengthen capacity of the civil society. What do artists do?
I'm sorry, this is the GIZ that mission to strengthen capacity.
Right, I mean, this is what we as the German government institution do. So, but we are not fostering arts because we do have the Goethe-Institut. So why do you wander off? And then you do have, again, have to clarify and have to explain why and how we do it. And so I find myself always between all these different seats and have to explain. So I have to explain to the artists, this is not what we do. I have to explain to the GIZ or to the BMZ, the ministry who gives the money, why is it what we do? And but after 5 years now, having done that and being fortunate enough also here on this panel with Cesar and the other artists, I find myself also that it is right and it is necessary to go forward with this work, because our intervention as a development cooperation is an intervention, and I use this word consciously, that is limited in time and resources. And of course, when we leave, and I will be, and I'm certain that after another 3 years, our project will go on for another 3 years, we won't have peace in Colombia. But we will have, hopefully, more people, more activists like Caesar, who can contribute and go on fighting that war, if you want.
Could I just to clarify your collaboration, would you say since 5 years consists in, I mean, what do you do together?
Well, for example, what Cesar just mentioned, when we got together is, so we wanted to understand where does he come from, what why is he doing what he's doing, and when we said this, so in a collaborative effort, meaning actually sit together and discuss, so what is it you do, why you do it. I mean, I always say, you know, our role coming from the outside is ask odd questions. And this is what we did. So we asked lots of questions, and this is how we came together. And that's what we did.
Yeah, es eso lo que ha hecho posible que esto ha hecho posible que podamos construir un texto guía que se llama Los 13 Principios, que son las 13 guías que un artista, por lo menos en el contexto colombiano, podría seguir si quisiera intervenir artísticamente en distintas comunidades. Es muy largo contar cada uno de esos 13 pasos, pero ubicarse correctamente, no hacer una acción dañando a la comunidad, utilizar las emociones como un activo. Hay uno de esos principios que para mí es importante, y es el arte y el artista como influenciador. Hay una historia que me toma 30 segundos contar. Un líder de la guerrilla estaba escondido en una finca. Y sus combatientes lo vieron toda la noche oyendo la misma canción. Oyendo una misma canción toda la noche. Y la repetía una y otra vez. Al otro día él se despierta y dice, vamos a firmar la paz con el gobierno nacional. Y la reflexión que hay allí es la influencia que haya podido causar el estado anímico en una decisión que tuvo que ver con todo un país. O un presidente de los Estados Unidos que decía que todas las decisiones más importantes las consultaba con una escultura que tenía en su oficina. Y es, y realmente, la, por supuesto, la escultura no le va a contestar. Es él preguntándose a sí mismo a través de la escultura. Todas esas reflexiones y esas pistas que fuimos atrapando durante este recorrido han sido posibles gracias a este proceso de sistematización, y así es como ha funcionado esa cooperación.
And there were also, no, did you travel also, I don't know, to Rwanda, and I heard that somewhere?
Yeah, but this was not financed by us.
Yeah.
I mean, his engagement with the Escopetara dates back, as he just mentioned, till 2003. This was long before we started our project. And actually, he was working with the UNESCO as a messenger of peace. So this was the other, like to India, where the Escopetara is now, and in other places. I just wanted to mention once and to stress that point. Cesar told me once that his idea is also to leave this instrument, which of course, as a German seeing this instrument, what comes to mind is another, you know, Schwerter zu Pflugscharen.
Swords to plowshares.
Right. Yeah. And it's such a powerful symbol, what we want to do also with the work in conflict transformation. So, of course, that was, I mean, it was just fitting, perfect fit. But then he said he wanted to leave this instrument all over the world in certain places. And of course I said, well, Berlin is one of the places where it has to go. So this is where in 2009 we were able to give it symbolically to the city of Berlin. And Cesar insisted that this guitar, this Escopetara, would be used. Unfortunately, I have to say that this wish wasn't really granted. So this Escopetara went into the Werkstatt der Kulturen, I think. It's there on exposition. And supposedly, it could be taken out by any artist who wants to and play and work with it. Because for us, it would be also very important that it is getting used. And also for us, the feedback would be very interesting, that it would be, you know, that really this collaboration or this learning from each other would happen. Unfortunately, until the day today, it hasn't happened. Seit 2009.
We have, I was told 10 minutes, about 5 minutes ago. So I invite you to speak.
I just want to send a question of clarifying. And we have here the Zakapas, and you are talking about 13 principles. I just don't know how everything relates. I mean, you said something that there is already an organization who is doing work in Colombia. When you go back, there are people who are doing something. I don't know how this relates to Zacapaz and how it relates to the certain principles.
This is the GIZ project.
Well, Zacapaz is a bilateral cooperation project where the GTZ, and this is the name of the project, and it's the website of the project. And the project is fostering peace development by cooperation between state and civil society. That's the whole, and that's the name in Spanish. And it's within this framework of that project that we are working together.
The question was about the 13 principles.
Sí, pues son este proceso está construido sobre las anécdotas y las historias de las comunidades, de sus problemas que hemos descubierto cuando hemos llegado a los lugares. Y ser capaz inició un proceso que era muy, muy arriesgado, y era cogerme a mí como conejillo de indias, como experimento, para tratar de descubrir una cosa que los artistas no sabemos, nunca, y es cómo hacemos lo que hacemos. Y el experimento fue exitoso. Tenemos ahora una guía que nos permite acercarnos a las comunidades más exitosamente.
Maybe if I just can add a bit, these 13 principles is more or less a guideline or some orientation how an intervention like Cesar did with his, you know, out of his impetus could be repeated, and then what it is you have to consider when you go into the communities and want to do something. The whole idea is taking this experiment or this experience and try to make it replicable. Of course, in the sense that somebody else, if somebody else wants to do something similar, what it is you have to be aware of.
I understand that, but who has agreed upon these principles, or who has defined these principles? So
who has defined the principles? Cesar. Okay. Oh, okay.
Hola, hace un momento tú decías que tenías que ir explicando siempre por qué el arte, por qué los artistas, y nosotros sabemos, pero yo creo que es al revés, ¿no? Históricamente los artistas en las sociedades han sido parte, cuando un niño nace, cuando una persona muere, acompaña a la fiesta, son parte del cotidiano, ¿no? Porque además tienen la capacidad de producir indignación. Lo que, por ejemplo, en Villa El Salvador buscamos y en Perú es pasar de la cultura de la sumisión, donde todos los problemas y el atropello se han naturalizado, donde es normal que cada mañana muera alguien baleado, ¿no? Y pasar de una cultura de la sumisión a una cultura de la indignación, porque solo eso te da como el argumento, la energía vital para poder reclamar. Y entonces el arte ahí juega un rol sumamente importante. Para mí la pregunta sería al revés: ¿en qué momento los artistas y las sociedades se dividieron y dejaron de ser parte importante y piezas en el proceso de desarrollo y de construcción de las ciudades a convertirse en seres especiales, ¿no? Alejados y en burbujas, alejados de lo que pasa en el cotidiano? Entonces yo creo que la pregunta deberíamos hacérnosla por ese lado. No sé.
Thank you. This was a comment, no? Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, we are nearly at the end of this panel or this workshop situation. I would like to question, because we have this title, No Change Angels, and we started when we designed somehow this panel with this title of the artist as the change agent. So there is a big difference in the meaning of being an angel or being an agent. And I would like to raise up the question, which is I could really feel inside of the whole conference as well, but I mean this critique, on the one hand we've now heard a lot of examples how I would say like the Western organizations like the GIZ or Goethe-Institut or the IFA, where Leah Pajowski's exhibition is now going
on. Which you represent.
Yeah, I represent this institution, so I'm also part of the whole designers of the conference. But in fact, what I would like to know is this critique also to the Western organizations as we represent. We had now very positive examples how these institutions are influencing or giving money and also giving the freedom in the arts. But on the other hand, there is somehow a use as... Sorry?
Closer.
Okay, sorry. Oh, that's quite different. But I would like to know a little bit more a reflection on this, especially from the artist's side, because, I mean, as you asked, more or less half or more than the half of the audience is artists here. What is your self-understanding? Like, are you satisfied to be an agent, or do you feel like an agent, or do you feel like an angel, or what's like your reflection on this?
That was to you.
refer to you.
I'm not an artist, as we know now by now.
But an angel.
Neither an angel. But Engineers. I... maybe. Somebody called me fuel sometimes, that we give the fuel for process. And I think that's quite an interesting analogy. I see like our role as supporting agents, if you will. But the support, yes, it does come with strings attached in some cases. And that's all.
I'm not an angel, I'm an agent. and also I support a kind of the other agents in my context and so on. And since some years I try to, I mean criticism only doesn't work anymore, so we have to build things, I feel like that. And since some years I'm more convinced that, I mean, every help and makes the ball become bigger. But I think in difficult contexts, we were there, that's why I'm talking. I think the best is to let something behind. And I'm talking about a room like that, in which to have exhibitions, in which to have debates, people knowing what they want, to meet there and to do, because the problem is in Romania, we lost all the state spaces. The public space, let's say it's practical only in summer and spring, maybe, and a little bit autumn, but in winter you take a break. So, and I will need a space, not official, only a simple room, I'm sure will make a bigger difference, because in Romania a lot of young artists have energy and they address really interesting and important issues, but a little bit they are they don't have where to meet and to do a little bit more. And I'm sustaining the idea of education. I don't know how it's to be made, but have to be continuing and supporting and so on.
I would say I'm also not an angel or an agent, but perhaps part of an engine, a small part of an engine. And I also wanted to respond to the question of this freedom. I mean, it's something that I forgot to mention when I spoke about this project, that the funders gave me the freedom, like, when they approached me, they said, there's this conference, we approach you because, and we don't want you to be polite. And it felt like, you know, these people, you said I'm a nice person, but I'm not that nice. And for me, like, if somebody says, don't be polite about a topic, it's like, wow, you know, these are the wings. And I could fly, and I mean, I think in the end I was polite, but to have this stated to me that you have freedom not to be polite about the topic was amazing.
Cesar, are you an agent for GTZ, GIZ?
No, stavo pensando en en un país como Colombia, donde algo como el 5% del presupuesto nacional está destinado a la guerra, donde se cierra un hospital que atiende 40.000 personas al mes gratuitamente, pero se compran helicópteros que cuestan 17 millones de dólares. Es nuestra responsabilidad ser tan efectivos como la violencia. Y si hay algo que es efectivo y por eso funciona, es la violencia, la velocidad de la bala, la contundencia de eliminar al otro para imponer un argumento. Y por eso nosotros, como lo dicen los libros, tal vez tenemos que combinar todas las formas de lucha en todos los terrenos con nuestras herramientas artísticas. Y eso significa entregarle el proyecto de vida enteramente a esta causa, que a lo mejor ni siquiera veremos moverse, pero que le da sentido porque inspira a nuevas y a nuevas generaciones que vienen cargadas de nuevas maneras de decir las cosas. Ahora yo regreso a Colombia a tratar de grabar un disco con los jóvenes raperos de las comunas de Medellín. Y el proceso será el mismo, llegar a extender la mano oficina por oficina para poder materializar este disco. Para nosotros es un asunto de vida o muerte, literalmente. Y así nos jugamos todos los días el pellejo en un proceso como estos, que esperamos tenga buenos resultados.
Is this the end? No.
This could be considered a comment or a question if Peter wants to elaborate more, but I'm wondering about the paradigm or structure in which we are working in development, including foreign funding that could be attached to either agendas or certain strings, as Peter expressed, or bureaucracies, work being done by paid workers who also care about their careers and they don't want to lose their jobs, etc., etc., particularly in more politicized and sensitive contexts and more polarized contexts, perhaps like in Palestine or the Palestinian refugees. To which extent does this paradigm has actual limitations to reach actual social transformation or change, and to which extent shall we accept this paradigm as at least we're doing something, there's some changes on the ground, or have we reached a point in time where we should perhaps start researching and thinking about alternative paradigms? Have we reached the stage, or shall we accept the status quo?
Can I take this as a final statement for the session? I think it would be very fitting. And the long discussion can ensue over lunch. Thank you very much. To everybody, including you.